Good evening. Welcome to another APS talk. I am Jeremy Vassallo, CSR manager at APS Bank. Honeybees are considered to be the most important organism for pollination, with most of the fruit we eat, along with many wildflowers, being pollinated by these insects. Apart from producing honey and collecting pollen for its young ones, the honeybee can also produce propolis, royal jelly, and beeswax. They are also insects and honeybee community. They are also social insects, and honeybee communities exhibit a range of social behaviors such as division of labor and excellent communication. Unfortunately, their population is decreasing due to constant human intervention. This and more will be discussed this evening with our speaker and expert of today's APS talk, Professor David Mifsud. Allow me to briefly introduce Professor Mifsud. Prof. Mifsud works as an associate professor at the University of Malta and is the president of the Entomological Society of Malta and founder of the Association of Maltese Apiculturists. He has distinguished himself for his accomplishments in the biological sciences, particularly in the field of entomology and the preservation of honeybees. Prof. Mifsud dedicated most of his life for the study of insects. He has contributed in studies to better understand the decline in honeybee populations and was instrumental in coordinating meetings between European beekeeping associations and European commissioners responsible for health, which were fundamental for the banning of harmful insecticides to honeybees. He published more than 250 papers in scientific journals, most related to biodiversity studies in Malta, and provided detailed information on more than 2,000 living organisms, of which almost 800 species of insects were new records for the Maltese Islands. To date, Prof. Mifsud described over 80 new species of insects to science. He is also the editor of a peer-reviewed scientific journal entitled Bulletin of the Entomological Society of Malta, devoted to the study of insects in Malta, of which 11 volumes were published. 190 scientific papers providing information on more than 3,000 species of insects occurring in the Maltese Islands were generated. Before we start the presentation, we encourage you to type your questions in the Q&A section, which will be answered at the end of the session. For those of you who are following us on Facebook, please use the comments field. Without further ado, I pass on to our speaker, Professor Mifsud. Welcome, and thank you for accepting to be with us today.
Thank you, Jeremy. It's a great pleasure for me being here with all of you. I hope that we will have an interesting talk and everyone can appreciate what the marvelous work of bees can do for everyday life and to help us in this whole world, you know? So let's see. Shall we start?
Yes, please.
So I will share my screen, okay? Here we are. And here we are. Okay, so yes. So today we will try to focus on the importance of honeybees, you know? Now, as Jeremy told you in the very beginning, I would like that each one of you would see these organisms not as a single specimen, so just one honeybee, but this is a colony, you know? It's an entire aggregate of one single species, all of them working together. So one colony can have up to 70, 80,000 individuals, and they are all working together. Very often they are termed as a super organism, you know? They don't really need the help of a beekeeper or an entomologist or an expert to survive, you know? They can survive on their own, you know? And they can do everything, you know. Very often we are those who create problems to them, you know. So then we have to cater for the problems that we create in order that they can survive in a better environment. So this is a very important thing that you have to keep in mind during the entire talk. Also, I will try to explain little by little, because many people ask me, but how the bees, you know, how do they come together? How do they work together? How is it? Can we learn something from them? Yes, we can learn so many things from them. So I will try to address a few things, you know, because within this hour, we cannot do everything. First and foremost, as most of you probably know, insects represent the largest group of living organisms, you know. In fact, insects on their own account for more than 1 million described species, different species that live throughout the world. You know, most of them, the greatest species diversity is found in Southeast Asia, you know, but they are all over the planet, all over the planet. And because we have so many species of insects, you know, they have to be categorized in different groups, you know, so that those studying insects can find some form of pattern when they study these creatures, you know. So we subdivide them, and the largest of these subdivisions within insects are orders, you know. So we have different orders. There are some 30 different orders of insects in the world. And one very important order is the order known as Hymenoptera, where there are the bees, the ants, and the wasps, you know, and other small organisms put together. Why is this group of insects put together into this order? They are more or less put together here because they have a unique feature, you know, and this unique feature is the fact that they have two pairs of more or less transparent wings, hyaline wings, and when these wings come together, they can fly better together because there are a series of hooks onto from the hind wing to the forewing. You know, other orders of insects occur. For example, we have the beetles. This is a very big order. And beetles are recognized because they have the front pair of wings, you know, which are more leathery, you know, they are known as elytra. We have another big order of butterflies and moths, and these are characterized by the fact that on their wings, we have scales, you know. So each and every order have a unique feature. Honeybees are within this order, you know, honeybees are within this order. As you can see there, the photo in the middle, we have this honeybee on a flower of wild thyme. That's a photo actually taken in Malta. And some of these insects, some of these bees, ants, and wasps are actually social. So they live in groups, you know, as our honeybee. Very important also is this, people, that these honeybees, you know, that they produce honey, and we know that there are various subspecies all over Europe. You know, there are some 20 subspecies all over Europe. What does it mean, a subspecies? A subspecies means that within a certain area, within a certain territory, these bees, after thousands of years, they have adapted to that particular environment, and they morphologically, they are different from the rest, you know. In fact, even the honeybee in Malta, you know, it is well adapted to our climate, and it is different from the one present in Sicily and the one present in mainland Italy, and it is also different from the one present in North Africa. In fact, some 20 years ago, it was described as a new subspecies, and it was described as Apis mellifera rutneri. As many of you know, the word Malta, you know, probably derives from the word, from the Greek word mel, or the Latin word melita, and mel, it's a Greek word, actually means honey. These islands have always been notorious for their honey production. You know, in fact, we also find in ancient writings that Romans and other civilizations would come to our islands to steal our honey. And a testimony of this are, as you can see in this photo here, buildings, you know, where honeybees used to be reared, you know. In Maltese, such places are known as micpa, you know. And we find many of these all over the Maltese islands. You know, this one in particular here is the one found in Shemshiya. And the Maltese islands were always exceptional in the honey quality that they produce, especially the honey that is produced during summertime because of our wild thyme flowers, you know, that are mainly found in the northern parts of Malta, in Comino, and also in Gozo. Here we have another photo, and the photo on the left, that's me when I was much younger. There's a small michpa there, and once you enter through that small door, you will find these earth wooden jars, you know, in Maltese they are known as olla, where bees used to be reared, you know, and in many places around Malta, you can still see many of these important structures where our honeybee used to thrive. Now, very important, let's try to understand what's inside a colony of bees, you know. So in one single colony, we will have one single queen. And the single queen is the mother for all the other honeybees within the colony. If you look at the photo, at the bottom photo, you can see a queen in the very middle, and you can readily identify the queen because of its larger size, okay? And it is surrounded by worker bees, okay? Worker honeybees. Within a colony of bees, at certain periods of the year, we will also find males, or better known as drones. And these drones are required not all year round, you know, because they are, for example, in the Maltese Islands, you find the drones in March, April, May, and you will also find drones again at the end of summer. So, September, October, all right? And these drones are required so that if there are any new queens, any virgin queens, these drones can actually fecund these virgin queens. But we will talk about this in more detail later on. But for now, just note that sometimes we can have drones in the colony. The colony would also consist of immature stages. And the immature stages are the eggs, the larva, and the pupa. All right? And this is known as the brood, you know? On the right-hand side, you can see a photo of the honeycomb, and inside each cell, you can see a single egg. The egg will hatch into a first instar larva, so a small whitish grub, you know. This will be given food. It will grow into a second, a third, a fourth, a fifth instar, and finally, it will molt into a pupa, and from a pupa, an adult bee will emerge. This is pretty much like the life cycle of a butterfly, all right? Where we have an egg, larvae, which we call caterpillar, pupa, and then a butterfly. And this type of life cycle is known as complete metamorphosis, which means that from the larval stages are completely different from the adult stage of the honeybee. There are other insects such as grasshoppers, for example, where the life cycle is not like that. We call them incomplete metamorphosis because the young ones of the grasshoppers are very similar to the adult. Good. So let's go slightly further. Hopla. Here we are. Okay. So as Jeremy told you, we should not think of honeybees as factories for producing just honey. They are, the most important thing about honeybees is their pollination activity, all right? So they actually manage to pollinate most of the agricultural food that we eat, you know? They manage to pollinate many wildflowers out there. So they are the most important organism when it comes to pollination, all right? Many trees, many flowers are pollinated by this magnificent insect, you know? And pollination runs into millions and millions and millions of euros or dollars, you know? So this is very important. This is their most important role in the environment out there. Apart from this, they also produce honey. Yes, they produce honey because they know that in winter time or in summertime, they will not find any flowers from where they can take nectar. And therefore, they have to store these products, honey, so that when no flowers are available for them, they can actually feed on these reserves that they have accumulated over the previous months. But honeybees can also produce other things. For example, they have to produce beeswax, you know, in order to construct their honeycomb, for example. And you can see on the right-hand side, this photo, this whitish honeycomb just produced very fresh, you know, that's why the color is white, because once it ages, the color of this nice beeswax will turn from white to yellow, from yellow to light brown, to dark brown, and eventually to black, you know. And how do they produce this wax, this beeswax? Very important, again, here I have to stress what I've said in the beginning. Wax cannot be produced by one single bee, but it has to be an effort of a cohort of bees. They need to eat a lot of honey in order to heat up their internal mechanism. And they have four pairs, as you can see in the photo on the left, they have four pairs of glands under their abdomen. And these four pairs of glands, they can produce via a chemical reaction, a very small platelet in each of this beeswax. And then the bees inside the colony, they can take these small platelets of wax and they can build the honeycomb as they like. Also, in the middle photo, I'm showing these four wax glands, you know, in transverse section, and you can see four of them over there. So 1, 2, 3, 4. Another very important thing that I would like to highlight in this photo, and this is also why many people are afraid of bees, is the sting. Yes, honeybees have stings. There are honeybees, all right, in Australia and Southeast Asia, which are stingless. But unfortunately, the bees, honeybees in Europe, they have this sting. And many people are afraid of this sting. But people, remember one very important thing, that they will only use this sting if these creatures are in some way or another disturbed severely by us or by other animals, you know? So they know that if they are going to use this thing, they will die because part of their abdomen will remain with this thing and they will die. So they will only use it in emergency situations. Apart from this, also please note that the bee venom that is contained within this thing can be beneficial to some people. And there are certain conditions like muscular dystrophy, etc., where they are being treated with such bee venom. And sometimes we see that patients can get better with this particular chemical, this bee venom. So yeah, I think from this slide, we can go for the other slide. Okay, so far we said that bees are important in pollination. We said that they can produce honey, when we will talk further on this. We said that they can also produce beeswax, but bees can also produce another very important product, which is known as propolis. And what is this propolis? I had one student doing an undergrad and a master's dissertation on this product in Malta. It was a very successful study. This propolis, let me explain what is this propolis. So let's go a step further. Plants, many plants, in order to grow, they need to grow in a way that herbivores, animals, won't eat them. But there are many herbivores out there, many insects, which would eat plants for their survival. And the most important part of the plant that many herbivores will eat are the fresh part of the plant, the new parts that are going to grow, the new buds. So if all these herbivores out there are going to eat all the new buds of a tree, of a plant, this plant will never grow. So these buds, these new formation of plants are in a way protected with a chemical, with this propolis. And the honeybees are the only insects that can collect this chemical, this protection from these plants, take it to the hive, transform it, and produce this propolis. Okay, in Maltese it's called zift sometimes. It's a blackish thing that they use in order to seal their entrances. They also add it up with the wax in order to produce the honeycomb. And they use it for various, but essentially people, this propolis has a health benefit, has a health benefit. Don't forget that it's coming from a plant and it is protecting that plant, that bud, all right? The new growth of that particular plant. And the bees are using it. Also, we are using this propolis for our health, So this propolis very often is collected by beekeepers. It is dissolved in alcohol. Sometimes it can also be dissolved in water, and we can take it in order to increase our immune system, or we can also use it for external wounds, etc., etc. Now, this is very important, people. You can see on the right-hand side, this nice photo. And if you look carefully at that photo, we can see three different types of cells within the honeycomb that these honeybees can construct. So we have these normal cells over here. You can see probably my cursor. And these cells, all right, within those cells, these are small cells. Within those cells, we're going to have the production of bees. طيب. Now you can see on the right hand side other cells which are slightly larger in size, you know, these cells over here. These cells over here, which are slightly larger in size, are for drones. So in them, we have the development of a drone. Whereas, so a male, you know, whereas in these cells over here, which are slightly smaller, we have the development of worker bees, which are all females. Then we have another type of cell, which is this one over here, 1, 2, 3, which are much bigger, hanging down. And these cells, are they are known as queen cells. They are not usually present in the hive, but if something happens to the queen, we need these queen cells so that the bees can create a new queen. So far, so good, I hope. Good. Let's go further. Let's go a little bit further. Over here, I decided to give you a diagrammatic representation of the abdomen of the queen. And you can see that the queen has two pairs of large ovaries. In fact, the queen is much larger than the other worker bees. Genetically, they are the same. So the worker bees and the queen are genetically the same. They are two females. However, the queen, when it is still as a larva, as a small larva, it is given special food. And this food, the larva is actually floating in this food. The food is always present. And because of this, this larva is going to get bigger in size. And because the larva is going to get bigger in size, the bees construct a special cell that we have seen beforehand, which is much bigger than all the other cells, you know? And because it's much bigger, the abdomen is much bigger, so that we have this pair of ovaries. And these are important people because the queen can survive up to 4 years. And in these 4 years, its only activity is to lay eggs, to lay eggs. Now, it is very important, people, to note that when we have a new queen, a virgin queen, this queen needs to go out of the hive in order to reproduce with the males, with the drones. So it will take on the flight and it will go out and the drones will follow her. And they will reproduce with her in the air. Very often it can reproduce with 5, 6, or 7 drones within a 2 or 3 day period, you know? In doing so, this structure over here, the sac over here, which is known as a spermatheca, this will get filled up with sperm, okay? And this will stay there. It will be contained there throughout the entire life cycle of the queen. Now, the queen, this is one of those few organisms where the queen can control whether an egg which is laid is going to be fertilized or not. What does it mean, David? So, if an egg is detached from the ovaries, it will go down through this pair, through this duct here, you know? And once it's here, the queen can release this gate here so that one sperm will get out and fertilize the egg, so that the egg that the queen will deposit will be a fertilized egg, and therefore it is going to produce a female, a worker bee. However, the queen, once the egg is released from the ovaries, It can also stop this gate from opening. The egg will continue to go down here. The egg will be laid in the honeycomb, in one cell of the honeycomb, but it will be unfertilized. And if it is unfertilized, it means that it's going to generate a male, a drone. And this can only be done, people, because the queen, with its antenna, it will check the size of the cell. So if the cell is a small cell, as you have seen beforehand, a small cell is ideal for a female, it means that the queen will deposit there an egg which is fertilized. If with the antenna, the queen will sense that the cell is much larger in size, then it means that she needs to lay an egg which is unfertilized, and therefore it will create a drone. And that drone, people, is also slightly larger than a normal worker bee. And this is why the cells of a drone are slightly larger than those of a normal worker bee. Okay, so far so good, I hope. Let's go for the other one. And here, this is a representation. Many people ask me, but can you please tell us how many days one single honeybee can survive? It very often depends on the period of the year. For example, in winter time, many of the bees are within the colony and they are not doing much activity, you know, because it's cold weather out there, etc., etc. And because of this, especially in Northern Europe, the workers can live up to 5-6 months, all right? This is not usually the case for Malta, where we don't have long winters, you know, as in Northern Europe. In summertime, however, so in Malta, it means from mid-February till July, August, September, honeybees are extremely active. They are going out, fetching for flowers, looking for water, and getting all these products in their colony. And because they are so active, the life expectancy of a single bee is about 1 month, all right, 35 days, not more than that. As I told you, the queen can survive 3 to 4 years. Whereas the drones, so males, in summertime, they can survive up to 22 days. And in wintertime, when they are still within the colony, they can survive up to 2 months. And you can see the photos also. The photos speak for themselves. You know, we have a nice drone on the left-hand side, a nice drone. You can easily identify the drone because the compound eyes are touching each other, you know? In fact, drones can see from far away. And these eyes are very important so that they can spot a queen which is flying, so that they go and reproduce with the virgin queen. And on the right-hand side, we have a large queen there, a large abdomen, as I have explained, and around it, we have the worker bees. And as I told you beforehand, people, a queen and a worker bee are genetically identical, but the queen is going to be much larger than a worker bee because it is given special food. The special food is very often known as royal jelly. There are also beekeepers in Europe and in other parts of the world that keep bees to collect only royal jelly. And they will sell this royal jelly because many people think that this royal jelly is also a nutritious food for also humans, you know? So this is the only reason why a queen is much larger than a normal honeybee. And here, people, I've selected this diagrammatic representation of the internal organs of the honeybee. I would like to point out two important aspects, you know? This one here in the abdomen, the honey stomach, all right? This is very important, people. it's an expandable tissue, all right? It can go much larger, so that when the honeybee goes out there to collect nectar from the flowers, this honey stomach can expand. It can grow up to half the size of the entire abdomen. It fills up with nectar, and then the honeybee can go back to its colony and give this nectar to the other bees, you know, mouth by mouth. Another important organ within the bee is this one here, the rectum here, all right? This is where the feces needs to be collected there and eventually eliminated. This is also very important, people, because in winter time, when honeybees cannot go out from their hives, they collect all the excrements in this sac, and this sac very often in winter time can get much larger in size until weather conditions will get better, and then they can go out and they will release these wastes and toxic substances from their body. Very important also is the head region. Here we have a number of very important glands that are going to produce certain enzymes so that the nectar that the bees will produce can eventually transform into honey, if the case is required. And here, people, I'm going to speak a little bit about the behavior of bees inside the colony, because not all bees are doing the same job. So if we go from the photo on the left-hand side, we can see bees within the colony that are not flying, you know, so they are known as nurse bees. They stay there. They are usually 1 to 15 days old, all right? And they don't go out of the hive, and their work as nurse bees is within the colony. And what are they doing there? They are repairing wax, they are feeding the young ones, they are taking care of everything. If one larva die, they will remove it, and all this, you know? After 15 days, the nurse bee will become a forager. So it is able to fly. So it will start flying out of the hive, taking coordinates, understanding where the hive is with respect to the environment, and it will start going out in order to collect nectar, you know, from flowers, in order to collect pollen. The photo in the middle, we have a honeybee coming home, coming to its colony with the hind legs full with pollen. Pollen is a very important component. It is collected from flowers, and pollen is extremely rich in protein. And this protein, the bees will collect it. They can also store it within the honeycomb, and they give it, this is an important food source for their young ones, for their larvae. Sometimes also beekeepers, especially in Northern Europe, this pollen is also collected, and it is given as a food supplement to humans. In the last photo, far right, we have what are known as guard bees. What are they doing? As their name implies, they are guarding the hive from any invaders that may try to introduce themselves within the colony. So they are all the time guarding the hive. Another important aspect are the scout bees, people. And scout bees are very important. You know, these scout bees would go along the environment. I mean, these bees, you know, these foragers, they can fly up to 4 or 5 kilometers away from their hive, you know? And these scout bees are looking for the best flowers. For the best flowers, what do you mean, David? It means that they are looking for those flowers which are excellent in nectar. Excellent in nectar, what does it mean? It means that nectar which has the largest amount of sugars inside it. So if we have a red flower with 50% sugar and the yellow flower with nectar having 20% sugar, these scout bees will go inside the hive and they will tell all their mates, listen, go to this particular flower, because that particular flower contains nectar with a lot of sugars inside it, 50%. Ignore all the other flowers in the surroundings. Go for that one. And all of them will go for that particular flower. Okay, let's go further. People, bees also communicate between them. They produce these dances, you know, a round dance and a wagtail dance, you know. And they use these dances in order to communicate between themselves regarding food. If they do the round dance, it's going to indicate the presence of food close by, but it doesn't give any direction, you know? So there is food very close by and it's all there available for them. They just need to go out and find it, you know? Whereas the wagtail dance is much more elaborate, you know? They use it in order to indicate a source of food which is far away, 1 kilometer away. And they not only will tell via this dance, they are telling their mates, listen, there is a food source which is 1 kilometer away, and it also gives them a direction, you know, to the sun. So listen, you have to go northeast, you know, and fly for 1 kilometer. And then after that, you will see bees going there, you know. And in the 1950s, there was a scientist who actually won the Nobel Prize because he could decipher this particular wagtail dance. People, here I have produced a graph in order to help you to understand what is the annual honeybee life cycle, you know? And we can see that in the Maltese Islands, the population of the honeybee in one particular colony will go up. Can you see 12 are the months of the year. So we can see that from February till April, May, the colony of bees is going up, you know? So that means that the queen during this time is egg laying, you know, it's producing many eggs. Sometimes it can produce up to 1,000 eggs a day, you know? And then after April, we have a slight decrease, you know, there is summer. In summertime, not many flowers are available for the bees, but then after summertime, so September, the bee population will start increasing again, and we will have a second peak, you know, for the bees, and this peak is usually present in September, October, you know. These two peaks, people, they more or less address the availability of flowers out there in the Maltese Islands. As you know, February, March, April, this time of the year, we have many flowers out there. Therefore, the bees will go, collect nectar, bring it to the hive. They have much more nectar than actually is required for their survival, and they will transform this nectar into honey because they know that probably in the summer, they won't find so much flowers from where they can collect nectar. The same thing occurs after summertime. After summertime, we have two important flowers produced in the Maltese Islands, and this is flowers from carob trees and flowers from eucalyptus trees, you know? And because of the availability of these flowers and because the availability of this important food source and because of the first rains, the bees, the queen bee will produce another peak, another numerous larvae, so that the colony will again reach 60, 70,000 bees. And then it will decline in December, you know, this number will decline down. There is nothing much to do in winter time. They will use their honey reserves, et cetera, et cetera, so that another cycle will later occur. What is this over here? During this time of the year, March, April, and also after summertime, so this coincides exactly with these two peaks here, people. So this peak here and this peak here. In those two peaks, we can see swarm of bees. This year was incredible. You know, we've seen so many of them. I have had so many friends on Facebook telling me, listen, David, what are these here? All these bees clustered together with a rubble wall or with a particular tree. What are those? These are swarm of bees, people. And what is going on? What is going on is something very natural, a phenomenon known as swarming. So from the colony of bees, the old queen will decide to leave its original colony, and it will leave with a cohort of bees, I don't know, 10,000 bees, in order to establish a colony somewhere else. This happens due to so many reasons that it would take me 3 or 4 hours to explain, you know, but this is a natural process, and fundamentally, it's being done so that the DNA, the genetics of that particular colony will not remain in one place, but it can go and establish itself somewhere else. So this is a natural phenomenon. Obviously, the beekeeper will try to do everything in order that this thing will not happen, because he knows that if this swarm of bees will go out from his colony, most likely the amount of honey that the bees will produce will be much less than, because half of the colony actually escaped, you know, it swarmed away. But this is a natural phenomenon that bees do in order to maintain their genetic makeup in different parts of where they are. This one here, people, is a diagrammatic representation of what happens with the nectar that they bring into the hive. So we have bees, the foragers, getting the nectar, you know, filled with many, very often, people, the nectar from flowers is low in sugars, 20, 30% sugars. If the bees don't use all that for their own energy, for their own consumption, and an excess of it is available, they will store it as honey. But in order to store it as honey, they need to remove as much water as possible from this sugary solution. And this is only done, first of all, there are many enzymes involved, but also flipping their wings, you know, and creating these air currents over this nectar when it is inside the single cells within the honeycomb, and water will evaporate, you know. And once this solution within one cell is roughly 20% water, they will seal it. So what we see as seal, once the honey is sealed, then we know that this honey is ideal for consumption, for whatever, you know, because it only has 20% or less water inside it. So the honey that we are actually consuming is this type of honey. When the honeycomb is not covered, then there is something wrong. And here, people, I'm showing, this is one, a frame of bees. You can see that most of it, you know, so all this here is, these are kept brood. And here probably we have some 1,500 bees, which are going to emerge from there and start a new life cycle. You know, you can also see down here in this left hand corner here, you can see slightly larger cells, and in those cells we have drones. So here we have drones, and in the rest we have bees, you know, bees in the making, you know. The other cells which are not kept, which are not closed, this is all, most of it is honey. This is kept honey. So as I told you, this is less than 20% water. And same here, you know. Sometimes you can also see dark spots, you know. Here you have this dark spots, you know, here, here, and here, and here. Those dark spots are an indication that instead of honey there, we have pollen. So the bees will also collect those pollen baskets that they have at their hind legs. And this pollen is actually stored also within these cells. Good. Okay, I have only a couple of minutes left. So let's talk a little bit about diseases. So yes, unfortunately, people, honeybees are dying all over the world, and we are trying to do something in order to safeguard them, you know, in order to help them, you know. I mean, beekeepers throughout the world were not always very kind to bees, you know. And we need to have bees, and we need, this is very important, I would say, we cannot stress this organism. And we can stress this organism in many ways. For example, very simple people, if they are producing honey, this honey, they are producing it for their own needs, because they know that in winter time, they will find no more flowers, etc., from where they will get their food. But what do some beekeepers do? They will, once the honey is produced, they will collect it all from them. And then the bees are so stressed in summertime because they cannot find anywhere else from where they collect food. And this is also why sometimes we see very aggressive behavior in bees, you know, because of this mismanagement, you know. But when bees are very well managed, you know, and you don't take all their honey reserves, you take just a portion and you leave a portion for them for summer and another portion for winter time, they are much happier, you know. So we can live a happier world with them, you know. Bees can have diseases, as I told you, and many of these diseases come accidentally from other countries. Many people try to introduce foreign stock, and very often this foreign stock comes here with diseases. And once something comes with a particular disease, then this disease will spread throughout the Maltese Islands. And this is exactly what happened some 30 years ago in the 1990s, when we accidentally introduced via foreign bees this varroa mite. So this is a mite, as you can see on the bees here. These are like small ticks, you know, that actually attach themselves to the adult bee and take nutrients. But they also go within the immature stages of the honeybee and reproduce themselves there. And from one single mite, we produce 3, 4, 5 specimens, and from these 5 we go even further. So sometimes the bee colony gets overwhelmed because of all these mites, you know, all this varroa, and because of this the colony will collapse, you know, it will die. So it's very important, people, not to introduce other bees. You know, we have our endemic honeybee. I mean, this is a subspecies that naturally evolved in the Maltese Islands. It's different from all the other species that exist in the Mediterranean. So we should do our best in order to safeguard it. Unfortunately, if we're going to introduce foreign stock, our bees will reproduce with the foreign stock. And in so doing, we will lose our genetic makeup, the genetic makeup of these, our own local bees. I have been telling this to beekeepers since 20 years. So let's try to stick to this plan, you know, because we don't want to lose what is ours. This is a natural heritage and we don't want to lose it. Flowers, people. Different flowers produce different honeys, you know. So here we have a selection of different flowers which are present during springtime. You know, these flowers are practically available from February till May, depending on rainwater availability. So during these 3-4 months, honeybees are collecting nectar from all these different flowers, you know, borage, red clover, thistles, etc. So during springtime, honeybees in Malta are going to produce a honey which is produced from different flowers. And we call this a multifloral honey or spring honey. If our bees are located in the northern parts of Malta, such as Wardia, such as Comino, in many parts of Melliha, and many parts of Gozo also, from the 1st of June till the first 15 days of July, in the garrigue areas of these regions, we have a very important flower, extremely nectariferous, so it produces a lot of nectar, and this wildflower is wild thyme. And from this wild thyme, our bees can collect a monofloral honey, so honey produced from one single plant, because during that period of time, only that plant is in flower, and we can collect this honey on its own and mark it as a monofloral honey. We can call it summer honey, or we can even call it wild thyme honey. As I told you, after summertime, we have two important trees that are going to produce a lot of nectar. We have the carob tree, and we have also the eucalyptus trees. From both of them, practically, I would say that first we have the eucalyptus trees in blossom, and soon after 15 days, we have the carob trees in blossom. From these two trees, bees will collect nectar and produce a very dark colored honey. This honey crystallizes immediately, all right? Not like wild thyme honey, because it contains a lot of glucose. And this honey is marvelous, you know, it's very good. It goes extremely well with milk products, you know, such as ricotta. And many people ask for this special honey, And here we can see also the color differences, you know, of this honey. The first one here, this jar on the right, this is the spring honey, so the multifloral honey that I have just explained. The one in the middle, you can see it's much darker in color. It's from wild thymes. And the last one is a mixture of carob and eucalyptus nectar, you know? And this type of honey is dark brown to almost black in color. Here is how the honey extraction is carried out, you know, and in various regions, even though the Maltese islands are small, in various regions bees can produce different honey types. So people, it's 7:30. I think I am on time. I hope that Jeremy will not kill me, but I am exactly on time. So I think this is all I had to say, but I'm pretty sure that we have questions from the audience, and I would be very happy to answer any of these questions, you know, if I know the answer.
Thank you, profs. I think that all the participants can agree that you are so passionate about this subject. I think we could continue hearing you and listening to you.
For a couple of hours, for sure.
You know, because it's so interesting, and we have some questions as well. So that our guests, our participants are really interested in the subject. So let's start from the first one. James Atsopardimel is asking, how can you recognize the worker honeybees from the drones?
How can you recognize the worker honeybees from the drones? As I've told you, the drones are slightly larger. They are more chubby. Also, the drones, they don't have this thing, you know, so you can play with them. But a very important character of the drone is the head. So if you look at the head, you can see these two large compound eyes that they actually touch each other, you know? So practically half of the head is contained with these large eyes, you know? And this is not present in the worker honeybees.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for the insightful talk, Prosit. Question, can bees change their gender or switch roles?
Can bees change their gender or switch roles? So what can happen is this, people. What can happen is that sometimes the queen get killed, you know? And if they will not produce another queen, These bees, the worker bees, are left on their own without a queen. And if they are left alone, on their own, without a queen, for more than a month, for more than 25 days, what will happen is this. As you know, they are females just like the queen, but their ovaries are much smaller. They have never reproduced with a drone, so they can only lay eggs which are not fertilized. So if they are laying eggs which are not fertilized, they will give rise to drones, to only males. And this is their last resource, you know. What will happen is that they will start egg laying. Actually, they don't even know how to lay eggs, you know. So what will happen is that within one cell sometimes, you will not find a single egg, as we've seen in the photo, you know, but you can find 6, 7, 10 eggs, you know, together, because they have no idea how to lay eggs, you know. One of them will survive, but they will produce only males. And so what will be the ultimate goal of all this? The ultimate goal of all this, because they have no queen now, is that they produce these males so that hopefully one or two of these males will mate with a virgin queen eventually, so that this genetic material is not completely lost, you know? So this is their last resource.
I see. Alfred Baldacchino is asking, are bees and other fauna for that matter impacted by 5G antennas transmissions?
We don't know. I mean, there is a lot of research, you know? I mean, in the States and in many countries, bees have been dying with this colony collapse disorder. So practically you have a colony of bees, 70,000 bees, and within a couple of days, they disappear, you know? And I think that we cannot pinpoint just one single thing, you know, an antenna, mobile phones, or stress from the beekeepers, you know. I think it is a constellation of things, you know, put together that are stressing bees, you know. And when these things are put together, stressing the bee, we have these diseases, these colony collapse disorders taking place. And this is why probably bees are decreasing in number.
Connecting to the same question, there's another one saying, how is the increase in construction sites and hence the reduction of greenery area?
Yes, this is also a problem in Malta, you know, this is also a problem. In fact, 20 years ago in the Maltese Islands, we had 7,000 colonies of bees, you know. Nowadays, we have 3,000 or so colonies, you know, of bees. So, I mean, if you reduce the environment out there, you cannot have so much bees because it's not sustainable, you know. So this is very important. Also, the amount of rainwater is important, you know. I mean, in these last years, except for this last year, we had periods of drought, you know, and without water, we cannot have flowers that produce nectar. In fact, in these last years, we had very little honey, you know. I remember one particular year that was 2008, where we had so much honey, you know, because it was a very good year in terms of rainwater. But we haven't seen a good year since then, you know, except from this particular year. And we hope that this year, honey production will be topped up, you know.
You mentioned the 7,000 to 3,000, and Olga Tard is asking, is Maltese bee facing extinction?
It is not facing extinction. It is not facing extinction because we also at the University of Malta, we're doing a lot of breeding programs. We're getting experts, you know, to help us to breed our own bee. However, there needs to be a consensus. You know, we need to put people together, especially the beekeepers, you know, so that we stop introducing bees from outside. You know, many beekeepers have this tendency, you know, there is a particular bee, it's from Northern Italy, it's called Apis mellifera ligustica. And this bee, you know, has been bred in such a way that it's extremely docile, you know, it's extremely gentle, you know. So beekeepers all over the world want to rear this particular breed, you know. It's not on, you know, it's not on because this particular subspecies is not ideal for the conditions of Malta and Gozo. You know, we have made experiments in Malta doing this particular subspecies and the Maltese subspecies. And without our help, you know, without giving these bees anything, you know, the Italian bee, after 1 year, died. All of them were dead. Whereas the Maltese bee, after 2-3 years, without any help from our side, it continued to produce offsprings, to produce honey, etc., etc. So we know this, you know, we have published information on this. We have been doing experiments, scientific experiments, to prove this, you know. So let's not introduce things, you know. Let's be happy with what we have. Let's try to ameliorate what we have over here rather than introducing new things from abroad. Because what we have is good, is better than from that of other countries. This is my message, you know.
Thank you, profs. So Zoe J. Fletcher is asking, I am a herbalist.
I am a
herbalist. And I really value bees for pollinating my plants.
Yes.
I would like to know if there are any ethical concerns I should be aware of regarding the use of honey, beeswax, and propolis. At the moment, I'm not using them in my products because I don't know enough about it.
Ethical issues, I don't think so. There shouldn't be any ethical issues about these, you know. I mean, these are products that the bees are producing, you know. We can take, as I've said in the beginning, we don't take them all, but we can take part of them, you know, and we can use them. I mean, many people also are into apitherapy. So not only those things, but also bee venom, you know, and all these things. Yes, use them, you know, there is nothing wrong with that, you know, as long as we are in harmony with our bees.
Another question. We often hear that bees are among the most important creatures on Earth. Why is this so?
I wouldn't agree with this completely. They are very important because their numbers is phenomenal. You know, they are reared in large numbers, and therefore they are going to pollinate all our flowers, all our agricultural products. They are docile, so we can actually keep them close to a greenhouse. We can actually keep them close to our agricultural fields. With other insects, this cannot be done so easily, you know? I mean, you can see in California, you know, they have thousands and thousands of kilometers of almond trees, and they are all pollinated by bees, you know? You cannot do this with other insects, you know? You cannot do it, you know? You simply cannot do it. So this is the reason, you know? This is the reason.
Thank you. And Victor Guzman is asking, does the fact that man removes the honey from the hive and gives alternative food a substitute bothers or unbalances the bees' lives?
Yes. If you are going to take all the honey, yes, they are not happy about it, you know? Because honey is not just a sugary solution, you know? It's not just water, and this is what some beekeepers do, you know, that they will take all the honey that the bees collected from different flowers, you know, and during winter time, they introduce water with sugar. But what they have collected is not water and sugar, you know, they have collected from different flowers. You know, I would like to think of this, you know, for them, this honey, all these reserves that they have produced during springtime, you know, it's like a pharmacy for them, you know, it's so many things are inside it, and they know exactly what they need, you know, for their health, you know. Giving them water and sugar is nothing like what they have collected from natural flowers, you know. So yes, you will unbalance that and they will not like it. So leave some honey that they have collected, supplement it with this sugar solution during winter time, because you've taken some of their honey, so that there is a balance, you know. This balance is very important in nature, you know. I mean, one of my EU projects is that we are trying to create a product so that to re-stimulate the immune system of bees, you know. I mean, because we have been treating bees badly, their internal microorganisms, you know, their bacteria, etc. We have them also. I mean, when we take antibiotics, most of these things, we kill them, you know? And we know that many of these things are so beneficial to us, you know? The same are for bees, you know? So we are creating a type of probiotic and plant extract so that we can regenerate these good microorganisms within the bees. Because if we do this, if we succeed in this, we are more than sure that the honeybee will continue to proliferate for many, many more years, you know?
I think you have answered already Fiona Faruja's question with regards, she's asking whether when beekeepers import foreign bees to help pollinate their crops, are these a threat to our local bees? And it's a yes, because—
Yes, it's a big threat, you know, it's a big threat. It's a big threat, you know, it's a big threat because for one simple reason, you know, don't forget that we are talking on subspecies and subspecies can mate between them, you know, and when they mate between them, you know, then the genetic makeup of the Maltese honeybee is getting lost, you know.
Another one. How interesting. When in Malta do you find swarms of bees? Where?
Everywhere, practically this year, everywhere, you know, along roads, you know, near rubble walls with trees, you know, we found them also in high buildings, you know, at university. If you enter my profile, your university profile, we have seen a swarm also there, and we've made a nice video, and in 2 days we had 3,000 followers, you know, so you find them everywhere, you know, and we have to do everything in order to safeguard them, you know. There are some people which unfortunately, as soon as they see them, they get confused, they get so angry, they go, they put paper and they fire them and they kill them all. This shouldn't be the case, you know, because those are creatures which are unique, you know, so we have to safeguard them.
Another question from Zoe J. Fletcher. What can we do to ensure we are buying honey from keepers who leave enough honey for the bees over summer?
Now this, I cannot answer this question. This is impossible to answer, you know. But I would say that you should have a connection also from whom you are buying the honey. So go to his apiaries, talk to him, see what he is doing, see how he is treating his bees. And once you know this, then you know what type of honey you're buying. Then you would know how he is treating his bees, you know? And this can safeguard, probably this can answer this question, you know? So get to know the beekeeper, go to his apiary, look what he is doing. Why not? Why not?
Thank you. Evan Sudden is asking, how long have bees been present on the Maldives Islands and how did they arrive here?
We don't know. We don't know this. We don't know. But I would say that since this bee evolved in something that is unique, it is unique from the one present in North Africa and the one present in mainland Italy and in Sicily, I would say that this evolutionary sequence, this takes hundreds of years. It can take thousands of years. So they have been here for quite a long time for sure.
We have a question from Emily Young. She's aged seven.
Okay.
What is the difference between a wasp and a bee?
Okay, very good question. So a wasp, the colors are very different, you know, but one very important aspect is that a wasp first and foremost will collect, it will never produce honey. And also the sting of the wasp, so when the wasp will sting you, the sting will remain in the abdomen of the wasp, you know? Whereas when the honeybee will sting you, the sting will remain attached to your finger. And so this is a very big difference, you know? But also morphologically, you know, a wasp and a bee looks very, very different, you know?
Thank you. Thank you to Emily for her question.
Yes.
James Atsapardimeli, Manuka honey is particularly known for its health benefits. How come?
Look, how come? Because this honey produced in New Zealand, you know, they have made many experiments about it, you know, we know its benefits, etc. Having said this, however, people, the honey of a particular territory, if we are in Malta, our honey is as good as that. You know, we have done experiments. Our honey has antimicrobial activity and everything. The most important thing is one fundamental thing, that when you buy the honey, you need to know whether it was heat treated or not. Because if you heat treat the honey in order to remain in the liquid form, very often beekeepers heat treated, they give it a heat treat of 60, 70, 80 degrees, you know, and then they cool it down, you know. And with this heat treatment, the honey will remain in the liquid form for a longer period of time, you know, because people prefer to have it like that, you know. This is not good, you know, to say the least, you know, because in doing so, you are destroying some unique products which you will not find in any other food source, you know. So when you are dealing with honey, make sure that it is not heat treated. And if this honey coagulated in your jar, you know, don't heat it, you know, don't make a bagno maria, you know, in order to make it liquid again, because the more you do this, the more you, the strength of it, you know, all these products, all these natural products within it, you will destroy them all, you know. Also, use fresh honey, you know, don't keep it there for 2 years, you know, use it within a year. This is the same as olive oil, you know, use it, you know, within a year, you know, because the organoleptic properties of it are going to vanish, you know, after a year. It will remain okay, but the taste and the natural properties of it will disappear.
I think I'm mindful about of time, and we have more questions. I think we take another 4 questions, and we
end there. Yeah.
So Verena Bonello Cole, how big a garden do you need to have a hive, and where would you start if you had to start learning about beekeeping from scratch?
Well, there are many courses on beekeeping. I mean, I do a course at university, you know. I'm a director of a center within university, Center for Liberal Arts and Sciences. And once every year, we do a 28-hour course there about bees from scratch, you know. So you just apply online and it's there, you know. But there are many NGOs, etc., who make these courses, you know, as well. So I don't want only to promote university, but there are many institutions who are trying to teach about bees, so that there is more awareness about them. And the first question was what? Because the
question was how big a garden you have to have in order to
you don't need to have a garden, my dear. You don't need to have a garden. I mean, I have some bees on my rooftop, you know, on my house. I don't have a garden, because don't forget that bees can fly up to 5 kilometers away, you know, and they will find flowers in the fields, you know, in the gardens of other people. So you don't need to have a garden.
So Yannicka Farrugia, thanks for this interesting presentation. I have 2 questions. Why do honeybees store pollen? And how many of these honeybees exist in the wild when compared to managed ones?
Okay, so the first question was again, but you have to give me question by one, you know, because I have some dementia and I tend to forget things.
Why do honeybees store pollen?
So honeybees store pollen because pollen is something from the flowers which is not always found, you know. So when they found flowers full of pollen, they will collect it, and some of it is giving immediately to their larva, so the larva continue to grow. But if there is excess of it, they will store it. They will literally cement it little by little within these single cells within the honeycomb, so that when pollen is not available out there, they will take it from there and continue to feed their young ones with it. And the second question was?
How many of these honeybees exist in the wild when compared to managed ones?
Practically, in the Maltese Islands, we don't have honeybees in the wild, you know. And there are very few places in Europe where we have wild colonies of honeybees. So most of them are all managed nowadays.
So I'm going to go for the last question. It's not the last, to be fair to you, there are more, but I'm mindful of time. And
if you want, you know, give me these questions, you know, I can answer them, you know, and type them, and then give them to the people later on, you know, so that I would love to answer all of them, you know.
Yes. So I'm going to Last question by Andrea Camilleri. Well done, Professor Mifsud, for an excellent presentation on a fascinating topic. Clearly, you are an expert on the subject and you love your work. It wasn't a question, it was just a comment. Okay, sorry.
Okay.
So let's go.
Thank you very much.
This is quite a long one. Carmen Mifsud. Sorry about that.
I hope it's not my sister, because I have a sister called Carmen Mifsud.
No, so it's from Carmen Mifsud just the same, but how does the propolis trigger the making of a queen?
How does what?
The propolis trigger the making of a queen?
No, the propolis won't trigger the making of a queen.
Okay.
The making of a queen is a subject on its own, you know? The making of a queen is triggered by only one single thing. The old queen going out of the hive, or else being killed, you know?
Okay.
Being killed accidentally by the beekeeper, or being killed by the bees themselves, you know, because they know that it's too old and they need to remove it, you know? Once this happens, then another process starts in order that the bees will produce a new queen, you know? So this is the only trigger.
Very good. Thank you very much for all the questions that we received, and also for your answers, which were
It was my pleasure. We can do it another time whenever you want.
I thank also our audience for the continued interest in the APS talk series. Today they have kept there until now, which were the ones who started following us at 6:35 are still there. We will be uploading the recording of today's session on the bank's YouTube channel and Facebook page by next week. And you will also be receiving a feedback form, which we encourage you to fill in, as we appreciate your valuable insights. An invitation for the next APS talk will be sent to those who accepted to receive invitations for future talks. I kindly ask you to share the promotion of our next APS talk so that we increase further the APS talks family. Thank you very much, Professor, again, and thank you all, and have a nice evening.
Thank you.